What's the directional vision of this show? Well, I have to be honest and say there wasn't much of one to start with. I suppose if there was a vision, it was a collective vision about how we might make work in an unexpected way. We gave ourselves a sort of crazy deadline, which is to make a show in 10 days for a Latitude Festival to do in their theatre tent. The thinking being that if it was really bad, nobody need ever see it again. And if it was good, we would then develop it into a fully fledged production. And there was something about that collection of people, we're all in one room, attacking Shakespeare's great play, but with lots of mad ideas of how to do it, that seemed to release the play for us. So though I think in some ways we don't necessarily follow the letter of the play, we're really true to the spirit of the play. And I suppose as a director, therefore, my job was to respond to other people's ideas, shape them, guide them, edit them, rather than me walking in the room with, like, I know how I want to do Midsummer Night's Dream. It was more that I knew how we could all approach it together and see what came out of those collective brains. So it was a more democratic process than one director's vision. We play around with ideas of theatre in the show. So when you first come in, there's a red curtain, Quince comes out, and then he does the famous 10-minute stand-up speech from Midsummer Night's Dream. Of course, there isn't one, but we do have a stand-up routine that opens the show, which sets up the kind of themes and complexity and the relationship with the audience. And then when the curtain goes out, you're confronted with this rather strange grey room with a band tucked up in a corner, and the play begins. And then as it happens, without giving too much away, the space is transformed as the fairies start to literally walk through the walls and into the space, until by the end of the show, the entire space has been affected by the kind of battleground of love that the play is. I think the brilliant thing about Shakespeare is if you do it right, whatever right means, but if you do it in a way that releases the deep potential of the plays, it's completely accessible to any audience. Some of the language is tricky, but what the action is, what the characters want, is really, really clear. All the characters in the play, or most of the characters in the play, are deeply in love with somebody, but there's a problem or an obstacle to them achieving their aim. The mechanicals really want to put on a play, and Pup really wants to mess everything up, and put those things in one big pot, stir them up, and chaos will ensue. It's the collaborative anarchy of all of us working together that I think unleashes and releases the play in our production in a way that all audiences can respond to. The important thing I think in Dream is you've got to find a way to convey the transition from the sort of oppression of Athens into the release of the forest. And we do that in a way by transforming the original space, and basically the walls are destroyed, the floors are destroyed, the ceilings destroyed, there's food everywhere, beer, cream, tents, everything like that is strewn across the stage at the end. So by the time the Puck comes on to ask you for your applause at the end of the play, you suddenly realise on what a journey, what a huge journey the production has taken the design on. I think also with costume, it's really important, I think, generally, I think, and here at the Lyric, that we don't cast the usual suspects. So there's certain things that happen without people thinking about, like Puck is a little guy with a squeaky voice, Bottom's a big fat guy, or whatever it might be. And we try to like play around with those ideas of who's playing the roles, and that's also reflected in the costumes that people have got. You know, Puck in our version is like a roadie with big boots, tall belt, black t-shirt, earpiece, who's, rather than being a sort of little sprite, is a reluctant and grumpy, aggressive presence, forced to work for this idiot who's Oberon. And Oberon, for example, obviously the king of the fairies, the possession of magic, but how do you do magic on stage? So our Oberon is really like bad at magic, and somehow his attempts to make it work means that when finally the magic spell works, you weirdly believe in it, maybe in a way more deeply than you would if he was just completely imperious and in command. Obviously these plays were written for over 400 years ago in a society that's very, very different to our own. But what remains the same is sort of the demands of theatre, and I think what Shakespeare did obviously was really understand the potential and power of theatre. And I think that's the way to approach the play and why the play is still relevant today. Because people still fall in love, people still make crazy decisions, people still fall out and are angry, people still really want to put on a play, and the play they're putting on might not be quite as good as they think it is. People still live in hierarchical systems which they want to subvert or they want to please, and all of those things are happening in the play. And it will be really familiar to anyone, the sort of chaos and anarchy of being in love. And I think that's why the play is relevant. And also I think that what's important to say is, though we have cut the play to a degree and we've taken some liberties with it, we're really true to the spirit of the play. We're disrespectfully respectful of Shakespeare's work.